name is Jason Donnell. I am a former FMF corpsman with the trip to Iraq. I was a helicopter corpsman. I was in the helicopters to come down, pick up the wounded, fly them out. Then once that mission was over, we went to a border transition team where we would travel the wonderful borders, western borders of Iraq, doing assessments of the Iraqi army, seeing if they're legit or not, and we'd train them up. So, of that 24-man unit, I was a sole medical provider, so I had to know my business. The training that we were trained on was, I don't know if you heard, called the Pig Lab, but it's OEMS, Operational Emergency Medical Skills, live tissue training. So we take pigs and we basically blow them up, lacerate them, blow their faces up, cut out every artery in their body, and suture them back together and keep them alive for the rest of the day. That was our job. And it was great training, wonderful training. Really shows the will to live. Just an animal that's sleeping versus a, what they would say, a pissed off 19-year-old Marine who's really trying to stay alive and kick some butt. So it was a great learning experience, something that those going over to Iraq in a healthcare or in a medical support role really need to learn. So it's great to be able to have that information and bring it back and share it, because I don't want to keep all this information up here. I want to get it out. Because if I'm the only one who knows it, something happens to me, it doesn't help me out. So, what we're going to cover today is I want to cover the, basically stop the bleeding. Because your body is basically a big bag. And once it gets out, you know, it's like a toothpaste. You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube, right? And if, I don't care how much CPR you give someone, if you can't keep oxygen in the body, in the blood, what's the purpose of giving them oxygen? That's why now the civilian side has gone from the A.B.C.s, you remember, the airway, breathing, circulation, you know, that they used to teach. Now they've gone to what, after what the military has shown, that you need to do the circulation first, airway, breathing, so now it's C.A.B. So what the military teaches is the M.A.R.C.H. protocol, M.A.R.C.H. That's for massive hemorrhaging, airway, respiration, circulation, and then head injury, hypothermia. So it's a whole nother protocol to learn, but it makes sense. So 80% of the deaths on the battlefield in Iraq and Afghanistan were from massive hemorrhaging, from blood loss. So that's why they developed this. This is the CAT, the Combat Aid Tourniquet. Okay? The civilian sector tells you tourniquet's the last measure. Well, if they tell you to do elevation, pressure points, pressure bandages, then a tourniquet, how much blood did you lose in the process of determining this is what you needed? So why not go straight to the blood stopper and then work your way down? Well, the reason why they say that is most people don't understand how to take and use one of these properly, and then how to de-escalate it if they need to. So they just try to play it safe. But I want to teach y'all how to be able to use these properly and also de-escalate them. So the parts of this CAT right here is, got your buckle, you've got the windlass or the crank or the rod, people call them certain things, but it's called the windlass. This is your strap. It's all Velcro all the way down. It's designed with plastic welding rivets on here, right? So it's just like tack welded with plastic. So to use these effectively, you have to tighten this down on the body as tight as you can physically get it before you start cranking, because if there's any slack in here, you can pop those rivets. That was more common on the older ones, like this one that's got the straight windlass. The new ones have kind of a barrel design, and I don't think they make, you can get these anymore. It's just more the training ones. But the ones that are the thicker rods, they'll take more abuse. So that's how you know the older ones from the new ones. And also the newer ones, they have this little tab right here that covers it so it doesn't pop open, but it'll be white right here, so you can write down the time you applied the tourniquet, because that's something that you always do with a tourniquet, is you write down the time, so that medical providers at the higher echelon of care will be able to know how long this tourniquet has been on this patient.
When it comes to using one, pull it out, just like this. You're going to, if it's a leg, you want to slide it all the way under the leg like this, and you pull it up. Some people like to keep them preloaded like this. My experience, this isn't really, because they think, oh, I can just slip it right on. Well, what if their lower leg or their arm can blow it off? Well, then you get to reach through here, pick up all the goo, all the vessels, all the broken bones, and you get to feed it through a hole. Or you can just slide it right under, come over, and even if you just get it through one of the holes, you'll be okay. Well, on a really big limb, you want to make sure, like a big thick thigh or something, yeah, use both of them. But if you've got like an arm or something that you can get a lot of wrap around, you'll more likely be okay. But, you know, it's just, it's good practice to use both of them. So, wrap it around. All right, let's say this is really tight, like it's supposed to be. You're gonna take this windlass, and you're gonna crank it. See how it wants to pull this tight? It's got the bunching up right there. Mm-hmm. After about two or three turns, you should be done. Anything more than that, you have too much slack and it's probably gonna break something. So, two to three, you should be done. Put that over it so this doesn't pop off, because that's what happens, that could pop and spin it up. So, you seat that down in there, cover that. Then what you're gonna do is you're gonna go down and you're gonna check for pulse. If you don't have a pulse, you did it right. If you still have a pulse, one more time, you know, because you don't have a true tourniquet if you have blood flow. A tourniquet, what it does, is think about like a garden hose up against a piece of 2x4. You know, you want to smash that garden hose up against that 2x4 until the water stops, because you're compressing an artery against the bone. That's why you never put it on a two-bone limb, a part of a limb. You never put it below the elbow or below the knee, because both those bones are designed to move and turn and twist around each other, so you don't have something to press it up against. And instead of just doing like the instructions say, 2 to 4 inches above the wound site, you actually don't know where the wound site is. So a good rule of thumb is go as high as you can up into the hip, crank down on it, attach it, write the time on it, and then move on to the next wound. But even if you're in doubt, you put the tourniquet on, you stop the bleeding, great. Now you just bought yourself some time. Now you can sit back, reassess the situation, go, all right, what do we got? You can clean it all off and go, you know what? It's not as bad as it looks, because it doesn't take a lot of blood to look really bad. So you're gonna, all right, I can convert this to a pressure dress. Since your tourniquet is not on the wound, your wound is free to treat and clean, do what you need to do. So you put your pressure dressing on, then you can start releasing that tourniquet. So if you do spring a leak, you'll start to see the bandage soaking blood. If you see that it's still soaking blood, the pressure bandage isn't working, you can tighten it right back up again and leave it in place. You know you truly need a tourniquet. However, let's say you start unloosening it and you find your pressure dressing is doing its job. It's not that severe. Fine, you just help that limb receive the blood that it needs, but you don't take that tourniquet off. Always leave it there, just in case. So, they're going to be going to a higher echelon of care anyway. So, let them deal with the tourniquet there, because they're going to suture it up, do their surgery, whatever they need to do. And so, you played it safe, and you were able to de-escalate, you know, and go down a notch when it comes to the intervention of the medical treatment. So, now since we're talking about pressure dressings, this is one of your more common and most used favorite pressure dressings. This is an Israeli bandage right here. So you've got the dressing, the bandage, and the cleat. All right? So I will show you how to properly apply one. If I could have some help from you.
Where's your mannequin?
It's actually, I'll show you my picture of it here in just a little bit. It's being utilized. All right, for argument's sake, let's just say he's got a laceration on that before. Pretty deep one, and it's pretty bad. So, what you want to do, dressing side, right on top. But you want the cleat to be right on top of the wound. The reason for that is because we're going to use this cleat as a pry to double the pressure or to increase the pressure on top of the wound, because the pressure's, you're not going to make a tourniquet out of this, but you're going to get close. So pay attention to how this is facing, because if you drop this, it's going to go rolling off somewhere as a pain. So that's something just to think about. So you've got the dressing on top of the wound, you've got the cleat right over the middle of the wound, and now you're going to pull this, right? So now you're putting pressure on. I can wrap around like this again. wrap around again. All right, now we've got a good, decent first wrap. On any kind of a pressure dressing, you want to cover the bandage completely, right? So there's white showing, still white showing here. The reason for that is to keep good pressure throughout and to make sure no debris gets in. So,
don't they have like a survival type shot show?
Come back down, and now that I'm coming back over the middle again, I'm going to give it a twist right on top of the wound. Because what that's going to do is increase the pressure on top of that wound. So every time you go to the middle, give it a twist. Come back around like this, half and half, we're splitting it. Coming up again, oh, in the middle, twist. Now I'm not doing this one near as hard as I did before because it's going to turn purple. But you'll get the idea. Twist. Twist. All right. Okay. Now at the end of it, they've got these little barbs, right? This is so you don't have to worry about tapes or anything like that. Take a piece like this, tuck it in that side like that, tuck it in there. There you go. It doesn't have to be pretty as long as it anchors itself in. And now you can see his hand started turning colors. I mean, always check, make sure you get a pulse. If you don't have a pulse, then you've effectively made a tourniquet, which you're probably not going to do. But you want to make sure you have a pulse, because if you don't, and you think you have a pressure dressing, you think that you've got blood flow, and you don't, then you could have issues, because you think you're getting blood flow. So you're going to forget about it. The 8 hours could be 10, 12, 20 hours with this bandage on there with no blood flow. Then you got problems. So, as long as you know you got blood flow, you want to check for pulse. You want to check what's called PMS, pulse motor sensation. So, check for pulse, right where I did that. The motor, you're going to make sure he can move his finger. Then you look for sensation, poke it, see if it says, ow, I can feel it, you're good to go. But also what you can do is just squeeze the thumbnail like that. If the blood fills the nail within 3 seconds, you're good. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. So, we were talking about keeping this up. If you drop it, it's going to go roll over the place, and then you're panicking because you're trying to. So, just keep that in mind. Any questions on the pressure dressing or the combat aid tourniquet?